Good morning.
Good morning.
I'd like to welcome you as we gather together this morning for worship, the beginning of the Advent season. My name is Nate Devlin. I'm the senior pastor here at Beverly Heights Church, and a special word of welcome and greeting to some of you who may be visiting from out of town, having come into town for the holiday week. We're glad that you are with us this morning. I'd like to invite you to stand with me now, as it is our practice and tradition, to stand and greet one another, if you would. Look for someone who looks familiar, perhaps someone less familiar. Shake their hands. Tell them you're glad to see them this morning. If you could please begin to make your way back to your pews, we'll invite Amy Lucas to come now and bring us our morning announcements.
Good morning. Welcome to Beverly Heights Church. We're so glad that you're here with us this morning on this first Sunday in Advent. And as Nate said, a special welcome if you are visiting with us. We're so happy that you've made your way here on this morning to join with us in worship today. The Gathered Seeds this week does have quite a few announcements for you. I want to bring some to your attention. The Life and Ministry of Beverly Heights Church is very, very busy these next few weeks, and so it's my pleasure to invite you to join us for many things in these upcoming weeks. First of all, our own Rick Wolling has written an Advent devotional based on the hymn, Thou Who Wast Rich Beyond All Measure. And it was emailed out to you this past week if you're on our distribution list. But if you prefer a physical copy of it to read through this Advent season, I invite you to pick one up. They are at the back entrances and then on the tables in the hallway right here behind us as well. Poinsettias are on sale beginning today, and so if you are interested in purchasing one, the sale is set up right out here in the hallway, and they'll be there after the service. If you would also like to purchase one online, that's an option available to you as well. You can go to the forms page on our website and fill out the information there as well. As always, if you have any questions, feel free to direct them to me in the office, and I will be glad to help. This upcoming Wednesday is our Maranatha party for children in grades 1 through 5. And the form for reservations for that is closed, but if you would like your child to attend and see if there's extra space, you are welcome to talk to Lisa Tiger, and she will see if she has room to squeeze another one or two in. So you can talk to her as soon as possible, because that does involve food, and so we want to make sure that we have all the materials and the food that we would need for that event. The birthday party for Jesus will be taking place next Saturday, and that is for our children who are birth through kindergarten. The RSVP form for that is still open. We invite you to sign up and invite neighbors and friends to come and join us for that wonderful morning. They'll be here at 10:30 until noon doing activities and crafts and having a snack. And if you have any questions about that or the Maranatha party, you can see Lisa Tiger. The form for our Advent family dinner is also closed for reservations. If you have not yet signed up for that dinner event that's happening next Sunday evening at 5 o'clock here at the church, you are welcome to contact Jen Tan, and she will see if we have space. We are just about reaching capacity, which is really exciting, but we also want to make sure we have enough tables set up and enough food for everyone, and so we ask that you please make a reservation and let us know you'll be coming so that we can make sure we have a space for you. The dessert for that evening will be your own Christmas cookies. So we invite you to bring a plate of Christmas cookies. We will set up a large table, and we will have a wonderful time together. Dinner's at 5, and then if you choose not to come to dinner, you're welcome to come here for the program. The program will be here in the sanctuary at 6, and then we'll have animals on the front lawn with a live nativity, and we'll sing carols around that following the program. It's a really fun evening, and the whole church family is invited to come and join us. If you wandered downstairs this morning, you may have seen in the Adult Resource Center a table set up with an overflow of items. It is our lost and found, actually probably from this whole past year. And so if you are missing something, or if you aren't sure, maybe you are missing something, but you don't know it, you're welcome to check out that table. There are a variety of items there. Coats and sweatshirts and cups and glasses and shoes. We're not quite sure how someone got home without them, but we have lots of things. And so please check it out. We'll be donating those items in the next week or so. Next Sunday is the last Sunday to bring in socks or donations for our Grow Living Stone event. And so if you have taken an angel off the tree from the trees out here, next Sunday is the last time to bring back those items. All the information you need is on the angels, but if you have questions, feel free to let me know. And then next Sunday, we will be beginning taking new directory photos for our picture directory. And so we have many new faces that we would love to have a photo of so that we can start learning names well. And so we would ask that you begin next Sunday being prepared to take your family photo. We'll be doing that, I believe, in the lounge. I will give you an update next Sunday to be sure. But we will be doing that for the Sundays in December, and then we will be putting something together in January so that you will have updated pictures for everyone. Thank you.
If you would now please take your bulletin and join with me in our invitation to worship. Come, let us worship the Lord. To you this morning with exceeding great joy as we enter into this Advent season, as we enter into worship today. We pray, Lord, that you would meet us, that you would come to us by grace and by the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, fill this place with the joy of knowing you, the joy of worshiping you, the joy of hearing your word read and proclaimed, the joy of prayer, the joy of confession, and the assurance of pardon from our sin, the joy of being blessed, Lord, by you as we prepare to go out into the world. Lord, may your joy be made complete today as your people gather and as your people worship, for you alone are worthy. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Our opening hymn of praise this morning is Come Thou Almighty King, hymn number 101 in the Trinity hymnal. I'd like to invite you to stand with me as we sing.
Come thou, Almighty King, hail
use of the bulletin, I'd like to invite you to join with me in a responsive reading taken from Psalm 16. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance. Therefore, my heart is glad and my whole being rejoices. My flesh also dwells, for you will not abandon my soul to Sheol or let your Holy One see corruption. Since we do find ourselves in the Advent season, we have the opportunity to continue to worship through the singing of our Advent hymn. Hymn number 196, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. Your attention now to the reading of God's Word. Our Old Testament lesson this morning is found in the 138th Psalm, Psalm of David, which David writes, I give you thanks, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I sing your praise. I bow down toward your holy temple and give thanks to your name for your steadfast love and your faithfulness. For you have exalted above all things your name and your word. On the day I called, you answered me. My strength of soul you increased. All the kings of the earth shall give you thanks, O Lord, for they have heard the words of your mouth, and they shall sing of the ways of the Lord. For great is the glory of the Lord. For though the Lord is high, he regards the lowly, but the haughty he knows from afar. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve my life. You stretch out your hand against the wrath of my enemies, and your right hand delivers me. The Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. Your steadfast love, O Lord, endures forever. Do not forsake the work of your hands. This is a tremendous psalm, a psalm of confidence that David writes and sings and speaks, a song of confidence in the Lord our God. It is a psalm that leads us into a time of reflection and also repentance. We recognize that David writes and tells us that God has exalted above all things his name and his word. We, the people of God, we struggle to do the same, to uphold the name of the Lord, to uphold the word of God, to follow the precepts that have been laid out for us in the scriptures. And so we have the opportunity to come before the Lord in confidence, knowing that he will hear us because of Christ Jesus, because of the life that he gave on our behalf in order that we might live, because Christ ascended on high and intercedes for us at the right hand of God the Father, we can come and we can pray. So I want to invite you to join with me in bowing your heads, bowing your hearts, searching your hearts and your minds, praying prayers of confession of sin, trusting that the Lord will hear us. Let us pray. You have exalted above all things your name and your word. On the day that I called, you answered me. You strengthened my soul. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, O Lord, you have preserved my life. Lord, we hear these words, this prayer of David. We think of the confidence that he had in you, the trust and the faith that you were with him, you loved him. Lord, what confidence we can have because we have not only the word of God that has been preserved for our benefit in the scriptures, we have the word of God that has been revealed to us in your Son. You have exalted above all things your word. And your word, the Lord Jesus Christ, was exalted on high on the cross. He died for our sins in order that we might be forgiven. And so, Lord, we come to you at the beginning of this Advent season. We desire to begin this Advent journey aright by searching our hearts and our minds, by confessing, Lord, our shortcomings to you. Lord, by coming to you and with vulnerability saying, Lord, I have failed. Please forgive me. Strengthen me, Lord, by your word. Strengthen me by grace. Help me to know of your love, even as David knew of your love. Help me to know Jesus. Minister, Lord, to each one of us the power of forgiveness. Reassure us, Lord, by your word and by your grace. And by the ministry of the Holy Spirit, reassure us, Lord, of your love for us and of our belonging to you. Do so this day and each day this Advent season as we make our way slowly but surely to our celebration when we will declare that Christ has come, the Word is made flesh, the Word is with us. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand as we continue to sing, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus.
Thank you.
quickly here at Beverly Heights Church. Just last week, just 3 days ago, it was the Thanksgiving season. And this morning, we find ourselves in the Advent season. This is the first of 4 Sundays in Advent. And as is our practice each and every Advent season, we have the opportunity to participate in an Advent liturgy, which includes the lighting of the Advent star. It also includes a reading and the choir, a singing and leading us in song. It also includes the children of the congregation to come and to make their way to the Bethlehem star. The front of the sanctuary is nigh filled up, and so I think if there are any children who are not in the tone chimes, who are still in the sanctuary, if you would make your way to the transept closest to the Bethlehem star, you're invited to come and make your way there if you would like, over on this side, next to the Fuller family. The Fuller family has been kind enough to agree to help lead us in our liturgy. You'll find the liturgy in just the following page in the bulletin following the late morning worship service. You'll see it say at the top of the page, Advent Liturgy. You'll need that for the next several minutes. And if you would now give your attention to Laura Fuller.
Hello? Oh, okay. Sorry. Please join us in our Advent Litany. It is with great anticipation that we come before the Lord this Advent season. We come and remember that long ago, the Word of God became flesh.
The Word of the Lord is upright, and all His work is done in faithfulness.
We come and remember that your Word is truth, and your Word is the Son of God.
In God, whose Word I praise, in God I trust, I shall not be afraid. What can flesh do to me?
We come knowing that the Scriptures bear witness to the Son of God. We come expectantly to hear you speak to us by your word. This Advent season, we desire that the fullness of the Word of God would make its impression on the minds and hearts of men and women, young and old.
My soul longs for your salvation. I hope in your word.
Star, we remember that Jesus is the Word of God who became flesh. The Word of God, what does that phrase mean? It is a curious way to describe Jesus. What does the Apostle John mean when he says this? Is Jesus something like language or words that are spoken? Is Jesus an idea that is communicated? What does John mean? Of course, John doesn't actually use the word word. He tells us that Jesus is the Logos, the divine Logos made flesh. Logos is a rich and wonderful term within antiquity that is sometimes translated as reason or rationality. According to antiquity, the world runs on reason because the world is rationally ordered and understood. But John tells us there is so much more to it than just reason. John picks up the term because he wants the world to know that the world is not just understood rationally, it must also be understood personally. There is a person behind the world. There is a person who is holding it all together, and that person has a name. His name is Jesus. It is Jesus who is the animating power that forms the world and the orienting principle that holds the world together. John goes one step further. Not only is the Logos personal, John reveals that the Logos is also divine. Jesus is the Logos, and he is the Theos. Jesus is God. Jesus is both personal and divine, which means that there is no better way that God could have revealed himself to the world. Jesus is the fullness of God, which means he is the full revelation of the Father to the world. Jesus made his dwelling among us, which means there is no greater invitation that could be offered to be in the right relationship with God. Jesus is the Word made flesh, which means that in him is life, and that life is the light of men. And so we light the Advent star this morning, remembering that Jesus is the fullness of God, the divine Logos, the light of men, and by him we are filled with life. And so together we sing, sing out with joy, the Savior will come. Please join us in our unison prayer.
Kids up here. Can you all see me? We are beginning our Advent journey. It is a season when we wait and we prepare and we mark the weeks of Advent by lighting the candle. There are 4 weeks, and then on the fifth time that we meet, which is on Christmas Eve, we light the Christ candle and we declare what? What do we say together as a congregation? Jesus Christ is born. And it's when this party starts after we light that candle. We get to enjoy Christmas and celebrate together. But until then, we wait and we count down. So we start the countdown today. It begins with 4. Can everybody go like this? All right. And it goes, it's very short today. All right. It's just 4. And then we go 3, 2, 1. Jesus Christ is born. You guys ready? Let's do it together. 4. And that's it. We don't go any further. In the meantime, you get to practice what? The sit tights. What are the sit tights? That's when you sit down like this and you put your hands under your legs and you just wait till Christmas comes. That's called the sit tights. And I had to do that every Advent season when I was a kid growing up. 25 days of sitting tight. Can you do that? Sure you can. Your mom and dad will help you. I guarantee it. All right. Thank you, kids. You're dismissed back to your parents. And tone chimers, you are dismissed as well. What a wonderful job they did. Well, at this time, I'd like to invite the ushers to come forward as we continue to worship now through the giving of our tithes and our offerings.
Thank you.
I'd like to invite you to take your Bibles and to turn with me to the Gospel of John, the first chapter. We find ourselves in the Advent season, and throughout the entirety of Advent, we will be directing our attention, focusing on John's prologue, the first chapter. The first several verses of the first chapter is considered by theologians and scholars and by pastors and by the church, really, since the gospel was written, is known as the prologue, in which John is giving us some cosmological perspective on what's happening, who Jesus is, and preparing to speak to the world the good news of Jesus by letting the world in on who Jesus is and where he came from. And so each week for five weeks, we'll be looking at John's prologue in John's gospel. As you know, we've been working slowly but surely through the entirety of the book of Isaiah. That will take us a while. And because we're trying to work through the entirety of the book, we're moving what might seem in a slow pace, but actually we're making our way through it quite expeditiously. And there's a lot in the text that we're leaving behind, a lot that is being left on the cutting room floor, if you will. And so an occasion like this, where we focus 5 weeks on one text, really gives us the opportunity to wring out all of the meaning and the nuance that we can try to get from a text like this. And I think even after 5 weeks, we will not have exhausted the depth dimension of all that the Apostle John is trying to reveal to us. But we will make an attempt. The other thing that I want to encourage you to do is to turn with me to John chapter 1. We're going to read it in unison. My hope and my intention is that after 5 weeks of reading this text together, we might in fact begin to commit it to memory. There's nothing wrong with hiding the Word of God in our hearts. And so reading this together as a congregation, as a community, over 5 weeks, I hope and trust will help to keep it firmly established in our hearts. I am reading from the ESV. You might not have an ESV copy of the Bible, but you can make use of the Pew Bible. If you can't, or if you don't, if you rather not to, that's fine. The translations are very close, and the Lord knows what His Word is intended to say. And so I'd like to invite you to stand with me now as we join together in a unison reading of John chapter 1, verses 1 through 18. Joining together, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. He came as a witness to bear witness about the light, that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to bear witness about the light. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory. Glory is of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness about him and cried out, "This was he of whom I said, 'He who comes after me ranks before me, because he was before me.' For from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, the only God, who is at the Father's side. He has made him known." And Heavenly Father, we do thank you for your word. We thank you that we can read your word together, that we can hide it deep into our hearts, that it can go with us and shape us and form us. Speak to us now by your word. This Advent season, both this morning and the weeks to come, and as we hear your word, Lord, may you be glorified. May your people worship. May you be found to be the word of God, full of grace and truth. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. Before I begin, I do want to direct your attention to something that we are making available to you. I don't know if you had the occasion to pick this up on your way in. They were behind the bulletins. There's a number that I see here to my left that are piled up. We have put together a resource that we hope will be beneficial to you. It's sermon notes for the 2021 Advent season. As I've had an occasion to speak with many of you in the congregation, you've shared with me some of you bring journals to the church in order to take notes. Some of you take notes in the margin of the bulletin, which I think is a helpful and useful practice. Some of you take notes inside your Bible, which I think is also a legitimate practice. But we thought that we would provide for you a takeaway of sermon notes. If you don't have a copy, you'd like to make your way forward and grab one, that certainly would be permissible. Follow Bethany's lead. She knows how to do it. And we're doing this as a bit of a beta test. If it is something that you as a congregation find helpful, we're considering putting one of these together at the beginning of the year for 52 weeks so that you can have sermon notes throughout the year. We're also happy to take any insights or recommendations that you have about the notes. You'll see when you open it up on the left-hand side, there's the gathered portion where you can jot down the big ideas and takeaways. You can jot down some of the applications that you'd like that you are making in your life there at the bottom left-hand side as you prepare to scatter into the world. There's a action steps here that you can make use of, the to-do for this week. Also, then on the adjacent page, there are the notes for the sermon, and there are five in here, so that throughout the 4 weeks of Advent and on Christmas Sunday, which is December 26th, you can take notes and then have those for your convenience. As I said, if you find this to be a helpful resource, please let us know as we prepare to potentially make these available for a year-long usage. We appreciate that. Well, we do find ourselves in the Advent season, and I think it's important from time to time to take just a moment to refresh ourselves as to what Advent is. I know that we have a number of new faces with us this morning and newer faces that are worshiping with us now here at Beverly Heights Church, and you may not have had an occasion to celebrate Advent. It was certainly not a practice that I participated in when I was growing up in the church. Our experience was non-denominational. It was more charismatic. It was not liturgical. We did not follow the church year or the church calendar. And so I didn't celebrate Advent at all until I came to Beverly Heights Church almost 18 years ago now. And since that time, I've grown to love the Advent season and all that happens in us and to us in that season, but also I've come to love the entire church calendar. It does help to make sense of our discipleship. Each and every season has a particular impact upon us to help us grow in our discipleship. And so I want to take just a moment to refresh ourselves as to what is intended to happen in the Advent season. Advent is a little bit like Lent. If you've also been here in the past, you may have also celebrated Lent. And you might be thinking, well, Advent and Lent, isn't that just leftovers from the Roman Catholic tradition? Didn't we who are part of the Reformed tradition let all of that go? Didn't we move beyond that? Well, the Church of Jesus Christ historically has followed these practices and these seasons throughout the year. And the Advent season and the Lenten season are times of preparation for feast days. Lent is a time of preparation that gets us ready for the celebration of or the feast day of Easter. Easter is a feast day in the life of the church. It is a day of celebration. Same with Christmas. Christmas is a feast day. It is a day in the life of the church in which we celebrate and remember that Jesus Christ is born. We do that on Christmas Eve, not so much on Christmas Day, but the Advent season prepares us and lends itself to us so that we might be ready to feast. Lent is unique in that it is a time of preparation where we focus on sin. Our attention goes to sin and the power of sin that has affected our lives and affected the world. We focus on sin in order that we might repent of our sin, remembering that Jesus Christ came and died in order that our sins might be forgiven. Advent is a season of preparation, but not where we focus on sin. It is where we focus on waiting. It is a time of preparation where we prepare by waiting. And like Lent, Advent has a certain twinge of sobriety to it. It is a season of sober reflection as we prepare and as we wait. Like Lent, Advent actually lies over there in the minor key, way over yonder there in that minor key. There's a little bit of sadness, a little bit of longing and seriousness that is supposed to accompany Advent. Think for yourself, if you have somebody who you know who has been lost to you, there's that sense of longing, isn't there, to be reunited with them. Perhaps they've moved away, or perhaps they've gone to be with the Lord, and you have this longing in you. If you really love them and you desire them and you desire to be with them, you have this longing that they might return to you. You're waiting for that moment, for that day when the holidays might come back around and you can be together as a family, or you're waiting and you're longing for that day when Christ will return, where he'll make all things new, and we will be with those who have preceded us in the Lord. Advent has a little bit of sobriety, just a twinge of sadness. But our culture tempts us. It tempts us to turn all of Advent into Christmas. As soon as Thanksgiving is over, if you're anything like me, we put away the Thanksgiving decorations and Black Friday becomes another Good Friday and we pull out the tree and we decorate the house and it's the most wonderful time of the year. And we enjoy it as a part of our family, and we're tempted as a church and as a culture to turn the entire Advent season into one month-long celebration, entire month in which we're continually celebrating Christmas, and we pass over Advent and all that is intended in preparing us by waiting. That's why one of the reasons I tend to favor the Advent hymn, O Come, O Come Emmanuel. I was asked one time at a Christmas party, what's your favorite Advent hymn? And I said, O Come Emmanuel. And there was a little bit of a strange look that I was shown. I mean, of all the great Advent hymns or Christmas hymns, why would you favor that? I favor it because when you sing it, you hear it, it's in the minor key. It can't help but evoke in me that sense of longing and that sense of waiting. You feel the tension in the music because there's tension in the season. Tension that builds week after week, and you're waiting and you're longing for it to resolve when Christmas comes. That's what Advent is intended to do. It's intended to help us to practice waiting, to practice longing, to practice patience and perseverance, even in the midst of tension. But I think we've all had more than enough tension over the last 12 months. I think we've all experienced a significant amount of tension over the last 21 months since the beginning of the pandemic. I was remembering with Alyssa and the staff as we were going through the worship service today, we remembered that we didn't do much of this last year. We didn't have the Advent family celebration. We didn't have the carol sing. Everything that we did in the worship service was muted and diluted and scaled back, and we have to kind of refresh ourselves as to all that was happening here. There's been that tension of things that have been held off. Things have been different. Things have been challenging. And I think we've had more than enough tension. And so this year, I want to take a slightly different approach to our Advent preparation. This year, our preparation will not so much be sober as joyful. This year, I want us to prepare joyfully. I want us to enter into the fullness of the joy that comes in our preparation for the celebration of the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. There is a proper place for sober, longing waiting, but this is not the year. This is the year for joy. Joyful preparation. How do we prepare joyfully? Well, that is the big idea of our text. That is the big idea of our entire sermon series this year. To prepare with joy means that we will, as a congregation, seek to enter into the fullness of Christ this Advent season. We are awaiting the fullness of God. There's something about being full that makes us happy. Something about full that elicits joy. There's something about effulgence. Don't you just love that word? I hear that word effulgence. We never use it, but it's a joyful word. We find ourselves filled up and with good cheer. I hope that that was your experience this Thanksgiving season. I hope that you are around a big table filled with a lot of food and a lot of people, and you ate your fill, and you had great conversation and good cheer, and you felt filled up, and you entered into the joy of Thanksgiving. I recognize that that may not be the case because of sin, because of the brokenness of the world in which we live in. Our holiday celebrations, our Thanksgiving feasts are not always as joyful as we want them to be, not always as joyful as they could be, but I believe that they can be and they will be in this place, among this family, as we find ourselves filled up with Christ over the next 4 weeks, as we find ourselves filled up with Jesus as we come to the celebration of his birth. This Advent season, we are preparing with joy as we progress through the fullness of Christ. As it's been revealed to us in John's gospel, 5 weeks looking at the fullness of God, awaiting the fullness of God, looking at the fullness of the Word this morning, the fullness of His glory next week, the fullness of His grace, the fullness of His truth, and then on Christmas Sunday, the fullness of His joy as we celebrate together that Jesus Christ has come, Jesus Christ is born, and Jesus Christ will come again. It's a time of joy. It's a time of joy as we are filled with His Word. Word. What is that? What does that mean? What is meant by the word Word in the Gospel of John? The Advent liturgy began to give some inclination as to what that means. Jesus is, as Andrew read for us, He is the Logos. He is the overarching reality. He is the forming principle of this world, the animating principle that brought the world into being. He is the power of God that holds the world in being. He holds it all together. But if we're going to enjoy the fullness of the Word, we must see Christ not only as the Logos, but also as salvation. Jesus is also the presence of God. Not only that, Jesus is the agency or the animating power of God. And to the principle of Logos, I want to add these three things. And so very quickly this morning, we consider salvation. Jesus is the Word of God, which means He is the salvation of God. Some of you know, if you've been here for a while, you know, as I've given voice to my appreciation for Eugene Peterson. I've come to appreciate his work. I was able to spend some time, actually, with Eugene Peterson as part of my doctoral studies when I was doing my doctoral degree at Trinity School for Ministry. Had the privilege of spending a few days with him in his cabin in Montana. If he has any notoriety or celebrity left in the culture, it's because he is known for his translation of the Bible into what he called the Message. Some have critiqued his translation, that it was actually didn't quite help the cause of the Christian faith in the world. I understand what some of those criticisms are. But when I had an opportunity to talk to Peterson, he shared with me that his intent in creating the message was that he wanted to put the Bible in what he called American. He wanted the people of this culture to read the Bible in American. He wanted the people of this culture to read the Bible as a book, as a story, as a narrative. And he wanted to take down some of the boundaries and the barriers and to have access to the book by reading it in what, again, what he called his American. And when you go to John's gospel, Peterson has a really helpful insight as he helps to translate the Bible into American for an American audience. He says in Genesis, God is presented as speaking the creation into existence. God speaks the word and it happens. Heaven and earth, ocean and streams, trees and grass, birds and fish, animals and humans, everything seen and unseen, called into being by God's word. In deliberate parallel to the opening words of Genesis, John presents God as speaking. So what is Peterson saying? In the opening chapter of the book of Genesis, Moses, as he writes, tells us that God is speaking the world into existence. And John, as he writes his gospel, stands in parallel to what Moses is doing and says God is speaking now, not the world into being, but John represents God as speaking salvation into being. Creation in Genesis, salvation in John. This time, God's word takes on human form and enters history in the person of Jesus. Jesus speaks the word and it happens. Forgiveness and judgment, healing and illumination, mercy and grace, joy and love, freedom and resurrection. Everything broken and fallen, sinful and diseased, called into salvation by God's spoken word. Jesus is salvation. For somewhere along the line, things went wrong. We're in desperate need of fixing. The fixing is all accomplished by speaking. God speaks salvation into being in the person of Jesus. Jesus in this account not only speaks the word of God, he is the word of God. Jesus is salvation. The word of God is the divine logos, and the word of God is God's personal message of salvation. My parents used a lot of turns of phrases with us when we were growing up. They used the sit tights with us. But I remember also there was an occasion, many occasions, in which my parents would say to me and my brother, they'd tell us to do something and they'd see us waiting. They'd see us doing the sit tights and it wasn't Advent season. And they'd look at us as if to say, what are you doing? And then they would, if the look didn't get us to move, then they would say something like this. What are you doing? Are you waiting for an engraved invitation? Let's go already. We as Christians, we're not waiting for an engraved invitation. We're waiting for a personal invitation. The invitation into salvation. And God gives us that invitation by giving us his son, his one and only son. God speaks salvation into the world. And the word that we hear is, come to me, Jesus says. I am coming into the world for you. Come to me. Who can't rejoice in that? The fullness of the word of God brings us joy because it is salvation, because it is presence. What is the word? Salvation and presence. And again, Peterson has been helpful to me. If you go to John chapter 1, verse 14, you know this well-rehearsed text of Scripture. This is the way that Peterson puts it in American. The word became flesh and blood and moved into the neighborhood. The word became flesh and tabernacled among us. The word became flesh and dwelt among us. Peterson says the word became flesh and blood and moved into the neighborhood. The word became flesh and blood and moved into my neighborhood. The word became flesh and blood and has moved into your neighborhood. The Word became flesh and blood, and it's become local. The Word became flesh and blood, and His power and His presence is real. The Word became flesh and blood and desires to take residence in our hearts. But Jesus doesn't want to be kept just in our hearts. Jesus wants to move into the neighborhood by His presence being mediated through our church. Because He wants to build His kingdom through the church. He wants to advance His kingdom through you. God came into the world in Jesus Christ in order to move into the neighborhood, in order to move into your hearts, in order to move into your houses, in order to move into your lives so that Jesus might be made known, His presence might be made known when you are scattered out into the world for the sake of the world. For the benefit of the world, for the goodness of the world, you have been invited in by God to share in His good work, to share His presence with an unbelieving world. The Word of God is the Logos, the fullness of it, meaning not only the orienting principle of the world, but it means salvation, it means presence, and it means agency. You've heard me say before, and I'll say again, words build worlds. The Word of God is a world-building reality. He called the world into being. He's calling His kingdom into being. God holds the whole world together. This is the power and the agency of Jesus Christ. And He comes into our neighborhood and He allows us to build worlds too, joyful worlds. Every occasion that we have to say, Merry Christmas. If you haven't had an occasion to read the devotion, I'd encourage you to do so. Rick, in the opening portion of the devotional, has some wonderful reflections on Christmas versus Xmas. I thought it was wonderful to read that. There's something powerful about saying, Merry Christmas. You're building a world. You're saying a benediction over every person that you speak to. I want you to enter into the joy of Christmas. I hope for your life that your life is full of the joy of Christ, even as my life is filled. Every time we have the occasion to say to someone else, I love you. You build a world. You say to them, I want to live in a world where I'm willing to sacrifice myself for your benefit, for your good. You are the object of my love, and I am willing to lay down my life in order that your life might thrive. I love you. Live in that world with me. Words have power. Words build worlds. In the same way, every word of anger, every word of jealousy, every word of hatred and malice and fear and doubt, they also build worlds. But the fullness of the Word of God has come and is coming again. We wait for Him. We wait for the salvation of Jesus, the full representation and the revelation of the salvation of Jesus and the presence of Jesus and the power of Jesus as He holds the world together. In this Advent season, we are waiting joyfully in the world that He has made for us and the life that He has given to us by grace. We're doing this for a reason. The work of preparation is for the joy of celebration. We must prepare with joy in order that we might celebrate with joy. Celebrating with joy is not a natural act. Certainly we'll celebrate ourselves. Certainly we'll draw attention to ourselves. We're happy when the birthday cake has the candles on it for me. But the opportunity that we have for each and every Advent season is to prepare with joy in order that we might celebrate with joy Christ's birthday, His revelation, His coming into the world, His salvation, His presence, His power at work in our life. We prepare with joy in order that we might celebrate with joy. So very quickly as we close, a few things that I want you to keep in mind. In order for us to prepare well, in order for us to prepare with joy so that we might celebrate with joy, first, we must keep company with the Word this Advent season. Company with the Word and with words. Consider the phrase, I believe. So much is communicated with those words. I believe is the difference between life and death. I believe, Jesus. I believe in your life. I believe in your coming long ago. I believe in your power at work in the world even now. I believe in the mission that you've given to your church to be the salt, light, and leaven of the kingdom of God. I believe that you love me and your desires for me and my desires for you. I believe. We must keep company with the Word and with our words. This Advent season is an invitation to prepare with joy by declaring as a church, we believe. And we must keep watch over our words. Keep company with our words and with the Word, and keep watch over our words. Like shepherds who kept watch over their flocks by night, we must keep watch over our words. Because words have a way of getting away from us. See, there's a subtle difference between a word of faith and a word of the flesh. There's a subtle difference between a word of wisdom and a word of fear. Subtle difference between a word that is aptly spoken and a word that is gossip. Subtle difference between a joke and an insult. They are all subtle, but they are real and consequential differences. And so we must this Advent season take care of our words. Joyful words. Loving words. Preparing words. We must keep company with the Word and with our words. We must keep watch over our words. And then finally, we must bring our words to life. And we do that by celebrating. I don't come naturally to celebration. I tend to avoid it. It was not something that we were raised with. It was a priority. Anniversaries and birthdays were things to be forgotten, not celebrated. And so for me, I have to make a concerted effort to practice celebration and to do so joyfully. We this year have an opportunity to enter into the joy. We've had the tension. Now is the time for joy. For the Lord has come. He's come in his fullness. And he will come again for you and for me. There's nothing else that I can think of that is worth celebrating greater than that. Will you join me this year? Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we desire to celebrate. We desire to enter into the joy of your salvation for us. We desire to enter into the joy of our desire and longing for you. We desire, Lord, we want to enter into the joy of preparing, waiting, knowing you, Lord, when you come. Help us, Lord, this Advent season to rejoice, to joy again and again and again throughout the weeks of Advent until we come to our Christmas celebration and when we feast and when we say, Jesus Christ is born. Help us, Lord, to do this well, to practice well, in order that the joy of the Lord might be known by your people, not just in worship, but as the church is scattered, as you scatter us as the salt, the light, and the leaven of the kingdom of God in the various places in our world. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like to invite you to stand with me now in our closing Advent prayer, which is inspired from Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 19. Joining together. For this reason, we bow our knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant us to be strengthened with his power through his Holy Spirit in our inner being, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith, that we, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that we may be filled with all the fullness of God. Amen.
Closing hymn this morning, hymn number 518, verses 1 and 3 only of Christ of all my hope the ground. Peace and be of good joy. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no man evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor all men and women. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with each one of you. Today, tomorrow, until Jesus comes again. And then indeed it shall be forevermore. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen. Go in peace.
There is nothing greater than the people of God joining together for worship on the Lord's Day. We're so very glad that you have been with us this morning on our live stream. We started our live stream ministry a number of years ago to serve those who could not be with us in residential worship. Here at Beverly Heights Church, we place a high value on worship. We believe that God has called us to gather by His love for us each and every Lord's Day. If you are close to us here in the greater Pittsburgh region, I want to personally welcome you and invite you to come and join with us in residential worship if you find yourself able. For those of you who may be joining us this morning who are not in the greater Pittsburgh region, I want to encourage you to consider finding a local church where you can worship on the Lord's Day. You could even consider going to the EPC's website where they have a church locator to help you find a local church home. God bless.